We're going to have the Donaldson's come to come. They're going to make the best they can out of the situation today. It's Mother's Day, and I don't know how they want to handle that, but we wanted to allow them a session or two to kind of highlight the results that we got from the marriage class. Kind of all ties in, but we would like for everybody to be in on it. So since today is kind of segmented, we'll make another stab at it. They can come and do whatever they feel they have to do today, but we'll take another stab at it on a Sunday when everybody is here. So at this time, we're going to present them, and they're going to come. In the name of the Lord, I know it's something good and different and unique. Always a surprise. Last Sunday was a surprise. Always a surprise. Bless and praise the Lord.
Amen.
Praise God.
Glory to God.
Yes.
Denise, not really. I'll start off right there. Denise, not really. I kind of agonized over this, knowing that it's Mother's Day. And no, I got it, because it's all what I'm doing right now is all symbolic of what this day is all about, what we're gonna talk about. You notice Denise isn't here with me. And our emphasis is marriage, right?
Yes.
So you young men, before you bring that woman into your life, in terms of marriage, you have to prepare the ground.
Yes.
Understand what I'm talking about?
Yes.
So Nisa's going to sit there while I prepare the ground.
All right.
You're going to kind of get in the middle. Marriage is a very, very, very serious thing that we have lately not been taking it too seriously in terms of God's way of what marriage is all about. Marriage is a very, very serious thing, and we're going to kind of combine this whole marriage thing to show you that even though we're talking about, or this day is all about motherhood cannot exist without marriage. Marriage in a biblical sense. Because once you have known a young lady, as the Bible said, you're actually married. You don't have to go through the traditional thing of going down to the courthouse and getting a license and all that. You're actually married. So in doing that, you produce a child, which then constitutes you becoming a mother in that sense. But once you get married, you automatically become, whether you have a biological child or not, you automatically become a mother and a father. But we're here to celebrate the mother. Because now your existence become an example to help someone grow. Your existence become a manner to nurture those who need nurturing.
Amen.
Mother's Day. Your existence is a mother. So we have to honor that existence, not on one day. We have to honor that existence every day.
Yes.
So if I can, in a very humble way, I like to honor my wife by introducing her to you all.
Amen.
As the love of my life, my best friend, someone who's there when I'm not there to help me, represent me, and be me. Because when you're married for a certain long, those who've been married for a while, you know that when your spouse is not there, you can actually become them. You've been around them so long that they don't have to say a word. You know what's going to be said or what's need to be done. There's no words that I can actually say to introduce her to you all that you all understand because of our personal relationship. So without further ado, I'd like to just have her come up here. Denise Donaldson. notice, I kind of had to do something to symbolize something else. Even though I prepared the way for her to come, she brought my books, did my help me.
Yes, yes. Amen.
See, it's not a one-sided thing, you all. It goes both ways. And I'm going to further prepare this ground a little bit for us. And I'm going to give you a few definitions, and then I'm going to turn this over to her.
I'm going to say right now.
I'm just so glad to be here.
Praise the Lord.
To come before you. It is our honor and privilege, and we thank Pastor and Mrs. Hill for that obligation to responsibility to do so. And so we look forward to presenting all that God has for us to talk to you about today.
We're not going to take a long time doing that. I like to really get into as far as the spiritual thing, like to pray, really pray. But we're not going to like I said, we agonize over this because we want to combine this into being Mother's Day. And right at the last minute, kind of, the Lord just hit me upside the head and say, it's all about Mother's Day. It's all about that marriage. It's all about parenting. It's all, because that's what God is to us, right?
Amen.
If you look at it, he's our parent. He's trying to prepare us for something. And if you want to find out what that something is, you have to come to the marriage class now. But he's trying to prepare us for something. It's like a parent, you know, that the child want to go out to this party, and the parent says, no, you can't go to the party, not understanding that party is not conducive to the direction that child is supposed to be going. God is doing us the same thing. A lot of things we like to do, we want to go out and do, but they're not conducive to what God has for us. Paul says all things are, come on, y'all, what's the word? All things are what? All things are lawful, but not all things are what?
Expedient.
In other words, not all things are not good for us to help us to mature and develop and to becoming that what God wants us to be. No, it might not send us to hell, but it ain't going to help us to become sons of God, daughters of God. Get us out of that childhood position. Walking around still drinking milk and not eating the meat of the word. So, I'm not looking for a lot of big cheers today. So I'm going to give you some definitions before I have Denise talk to you. Definitions that came out of the marriage class in terms of what marriage is and all about marriage, love, covenant, and relationship. Got these four definitions that really you need to write down. Even if you don't come to our class, you need to write this down because we're in a situation right now. We're in a time when Satan is really moving and doing things, and deception is exploding out of the world. And if you have these definitions, it can kind of help you with understanding what's going on, and you won't be deceived. It might look good, but you won't be deceived, knowing that it's not of God. So the first definition that I have is, what is marriage? Now the first definition is marriage. And from a biblical sense, you can't, this is not something I just grabbed out of the sky, because I derived this from Jesus himself. No, without really getting into any scriptures with it, but we know that in Matthew and Mark, there's a situation when Jesus was tempted by the Pharisees with divorce, right? You remember that? Some of y'all remember that?
Yeah.
And Jesus replied to him, if I could kind of paraphrase and put it in modern day language, Jesus replied to him, why are you going to ask me about divorce when you have no idea what marriage is really all about? And then he did what? He directed them. Then you know that they were male and female, made beginning male and female, and he said some other things. But this is where this definition comes from where Jesus directed them to what marriage is all about. So the definition of marriage based on scripture as a male and female come together to reflect the image and likeness of God.
Amen.
Do you hear me?
Amen.
Marriage is, you don't have this concept in your head, if you're not going about understanding this, then you're in a position that you're going to be really swamped up by the world, and you think marriage is all about finances. You're going to get caught up in your insecurities, and you don't think marriage is all about fulfilling myself. You might just get caught up in society and think because I might have got someone pregnant that marriage is all about doing the right thing. No. Marriage is male and female coming together to reflect, you hear me? Reflect the image and likeness of God.
Amen.
That sets the whole foundation of it right there. Because you coming together as a male and female to reflect God's image, that brings us to the next one. The next definition is, what is love? What is love? The world will try to tell you that love is a feeling, this great emotion that comes about you, that overcomes you, where you can't do anything. You just get all weak at the knees and you fall apart and you're doing all this old crazy mess. And for us men that are visual, the world would tell you that love is this beautiful young lady that absorbs your visual sight, that when you see her, you just lose all control of your faculties. That's called lust, for those who don't know. Where you're no longer able to do the right thing. That's not love. That's not love. Because if you understand what love is, like I tell them in the class, if you truly understood what love is, there's no way you could sit up and say, I love someone, and then I'll turn around the next day and say, I love my shoes.
Yeah.
You can't put them in the same category. If you understand what love is. I like my shoes. But there's no way I can love my shoes. I like my car, but there's no way I can love my car. So this is a definition, and this is a biblical definition. I can give you some scriptures, but I'm not going to give you scriptures today. You have to come to class. I'm setting you up for something here. Come on in. Pastor said, everybody needs to come. This is not a class based on the do's and don'ts. This is a class based on building the foundation up in you as an individual. So when you do get into a marriage or decide to get married, it's not about what your spouse is going to do. It's all about what I'm going to do. Because your spouse can get deceived in this time. Your spouse can fall. So if your spouse gets deceived, your spouse get blinded. We don't have the blind lead the blind. Somebody's got to stand up and minister to the other and bring the other back. So what is love? Scripturally speaking, straight to the point, love is God. So I'm recreating the image and likeness of God when we come together in the marriage. So if we come together to create the image and likeness of God, we got to have that which is love to be like God. So love is not only just God, but love is a spirit. And the scripture tells us that he gives a spirit of what? Power. Love and a sound mind. So love is not a feeling. Love is not an emotion. Love is not a head trip. Love is a decision brought about by a godly state of mind.
Yes.
Next definition that you need to have before you get into this thing called marriage and you need to understand is covenant. Unfortunately, we have been and I have to put it this way, it's not really a negative, because God brings us up and out of things. So as we grow out of things, it's just like I grew out of toys. I don't look back and look at toys and say, oh man, that's something I want to have. Now I look back at it as a process, you know, it's no longer necessary in my life. So God brings us up and out of things. So I'm not putting this as negatively, but God has brought Christianity, particularly in America, God has brought Christianity through a European influence. And because we came through this European influence, we kind of miss the essence of certain things that Jesus and God really have for us. We're getting there. We're going back. It comes back. It's like a circle. We're coming back. We got a lot of young people now. They're doing the prayer cloths. But in the process of doing the prayer cloths, they're going to find out what they really mean. We're starting to recognize Shabbat. You know, if you don't know what Shabbat is, Shabbat is the day of rest, the Sabbath, the real Sabbath, which is the day of rest. It starts from sundown Friday night to sundown Saturday night. These are some of the things that expedience that help us become what God wants to be, but it's not something that are lawful to us that we have to do that's going to prevent you from going to heaven. It's growth. So covenant kind of, because we came up in this European influence of Christianity, we missed some of the things. So one of those things we missed out on is covenant. So covenant definition from a biblical point of view is an unbreakable bond, irrevocable, inseparable bond between God and man.
Amen.
Denise wrote this one, so she kind of added a little more to it. That's okay. She knows me. An unbreakable bond and an inseparable bond, irreversible, inseparable bond between God and men. Between God and man. So what that got to do with marriage? That's how your mind goes. Not between God and man, because a marriage is between you and God, not between you and your spouse. When you go in that church and you say your vows, you're not saying your vows to your spouse. That's the misconception that a lot of us get into. And some of us even try to rewrite our vows, and we go to them and we look them down in the eyes and we try to express this little baby, I will walk the waters of a, you know. What kind of vow are we talking about today? Your vow in a marriage is not to your spouse. Your vow is to God as to what you're going to do for your spouse by becoming like God.
All right.
Yes. I gotta stop right here. I don't want to lose this because we're talking about Mother's Day now. Don't lose track of that. We're talking about Mother's Day. So covenant. Write that down. And then all to wrap this up a little bit, we came up with another definition, and that's relationship. We had to put this all together in this called relationship. And the definition of relationship is the way, and we can switch that word there, because a lot, and I think the English language uses this word to kind of get you out of what it's really all about. Because every time it say the way, it's saying something that we really don't like to hear. Because we come up in this kind of deceptive world. But the way actually means order. If I say, I want you to go to the store and I want you to go this way, what am I telling you? I want you to go in this order. I want you to make a left here, to make a right there, to make another left here, go down three blocks, and you'd be at the store. That's an order. So we can substitute this way with order. And every time you hear it, if you get into your mind when you start hearing order, you'll start recognizing something. But definition for relationship is the way, the order in which two or more persons connect, or state of being in connection. Did you hear what I said? I like the latter part. A state of being connected. Because marriage is a growth process. It's a state of being. It's not like you get connected and that's it. It's a state of being connected. So you're growing together to become connected even more and more and more and more. And that's called intimacy. And when you get to that point of intimacy that reflects the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, is why I'm teaching this class, so we can get marriage to start acting like the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Because within intimacy, the strongest power you got in two people in intimacy, like the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, is what? The power of agreement. And you will walk in the areas, and just like God, you will speak and there will become. You will speak. Originally, when God brought Adam and Eve together, that's what they did. They spoke it into existence.
Amen.
But we fail. They fail. So now we kind of regain what the devil stole. So that is the strive about what marriage is all about. That is what this day is all about. About motherhood. It's about marriage. Because out of marriage come children. Out of children comes a neighborhood. Out of that neighborhood comes a city, and out of that city comes a state, and out of that state becomes a country. I just told you something. If you're concerned about the state of our country right now, you not need to look back, because the breach has been broken. The foundation has been cracked. The marriage. The same thing that produced Donald Trump is the same thing that produced the Hitler. The marriage. That is why God created this system. It's a system of order, of authority. Talking about Mother's Day. A system of order, of authority to double cover the woman. Because she is the gateway. Y'all don't hear me.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Whether she having kids or not, or have had kids or not, she still is the potential gateway into this world. Yeah. Satan's here, but Satan's here illegally. Jesus came here legally. He came through the gateway, through the woman. So being so important that a woman is that gateway, he double covered her with the man and with himself. And I want to end it right there, because it's going to get into something that our next session is going to be about at the marriage. It's going to start right after summer is over, sometime in September, maybe a little later, but we all need to be here, and we're going to cover about the covering, about the head covering that's been so messed up and misconstrued. They took in Paul's example of long hair and took it out of the context and tried to make it this, that, whatever out of. And really all it's about is the same thing where God established an order of authority. So the woman will be covered. Motherhood.
Yes.
Motherhood, you're so important. Women, you are so important. God started first talking about dying for somebody. He talked about men dying for something. He was talking about men dying for the women. Sacrificing. We're supposed to be sacrificing for the women. We're supposed to keep that gateway covered. Keep that gateway. And see, it's not just a gateway of just giving birth, but it's a gateway of knowledge. Because through the first 5 years of a child, that nurturing, that being, I see you got a little young one here now, just nurtured, not just with substance, but with knowledge. You learn 95 or something like that, some like high number like that, if I remember right, So like 90% of what you're going to learn your whole lifetime, you're going to learn between birth and 5 years old. And who is that most influential person in your life between birth and 5 years old? Not just your parents, your mother. Your mother. Because I'm going to tell you something about, yeah, I'm going to tell you something about parenting. And I've seen this. A mom, because of her relationship, giving birth, having that child in there 9 months, then giving birth, and go, there's a connection that's between that mom and that child. That when the father come in and say, whatever, and the mother don't agree, she can wipe it right off the board, like eraser. Like he ain't even said nothing. And if you don't believe me, go to the Bible and look at all the kings of Israel and find out the ones that did bad and the ones that did good. They will say the emphasis as to why they did good or bad is because the mother emphasized the father in a particular light. I'm giving you all a little meat here. Little meat. But with that in mind, understand that this is motherhood, Mother's Day, and we're talking about motherhood, which is extremely important. We do a little thing in our marriage class, and it's called Dee's Corner. I kind of got a liking a little bit myself, but I'm sitting there, and when she's talking, I'm like, because I won't hear it until you all do it. I'm like, she had all that in there. I should have put it up there a long time ago. You know what I'm saying? But without further ado, this is my wife. She has a little Mother's Day and got a thing for y'all. We're going to do it in the sense that we do it at home, too. So she's going to have a mic. I'm going to have a mic. And you might have me see me say a few things. Because we want to be like an open book to you all. We don't want to be fake to you. Like, we come here, we act one way, and we're going to act another way at home. Now, we're going to show you exactly how we act when we act, you know? And believe me, if you ever come to our home, we act. You know, if you watch us in the marriage class, and if you look at us before we get started, you'll see a lot of that acting going on. You know what I'm talking about? That's because we love each other. And we made that commitment to God. But this is my wife, Denise Donaldson. She says I take up too much time.
Thank you, Michael, very much. You've introduced mainly a lot of my message. You talked about, about relationship. And so, because it's Mother's Day, I'm going to come with the relationship of the mother to the children and why that's so significant. Because he mentioned that marriage is male and female coming together and reflecting the image and likeness of God. So when we have kids, we have to train them up so that they will learn to become godly children. So that when they get married, they will already know. It just becomes, like they know their name. It's a habit. It's already instilled in them at a very young age. So I'm talking about raising up godly children. God has a plan and purpose, and he uses everything that he allows us to go through. He uses it for his purpose and his glory. There's nothing that happens in our lives that God will not use for its good.
Amen.
He's going to turn everything around for your good. So don't sit there and think, well, man, I did this and that. God's going to use that for his glory. He's going to turn it around for his good. So we need to learn to trust and to rely and depend on our Father God. He is the Alpha and the Omega. He is the first and the last. He helps us in every situation. We just need to call on him, depend on him, trust him, because he's going to get us through. We just reach out our hand and just hold on to God. And sometimes you're going through storms, you just hold on. God's got a plan. He's going to work it out. It's nothing that he won't do. So we raise up our children in the way of the Lord. We train them up in the Lord so that they will not depart from the Lord when they grow, when they get older. And they will continue to grow in the Lord. As a mom, I saw my job. Now this is because of my family and what I saw that was needed within my family. Each and every family is different, so you need to find out what is predominantly the role that you need to play as a mother in nurturing and training up your children. Mine, I saw my job to watch and to pray, and to teach and to guide, and to stop any distractions or hindrances that the devil would bring against my kids. So I taught them, you know, so first of all, I did not tolerate for a minute or even a second anything that Satan brought against my children. I was like a mama bear. I'd rise up and growl and said, oh no, not here. You need to find another place to go.
That's right.
You know, those are my kids, you know, and I'm not putting up with this. But I also had to train them to recognize it as well. Because we only have our kids for a short time, and they have to learn how to see and acknowledge and understand when they need to rise up and say, oh no, I know this. This is.
Can I give that one example?
This is. Okay.
Can I give that one example?
Oh, okay, go ahead.
See, I eat off a plate at home too.
Which one?
She talk about it, be something there opposite each other. But when our kids were real little, to show them the difference in how spiritual things change, the Lord had led me to take them into a rough part of town and late at night, real late, after 12 o'clock. And they begin to see and feel. When young kids are young, they can sense things. They really, before they get all inundated with society, they can sense things. And so I would take them to the party, just through the party district, and they can sense all this. Stuff wasn't right. So I did that about 3, maybe 4 times, and then they come back, and then the day, and take them through the same area the day, and the light was out, and everything was totally different. When they became an age and they started going out, did not have to give them a curfew. Just, where are you going? Oh, okay, see you when you get home. Even now, my kids make a point to try to get home before 12 o'clock.
Amen.
Because they can sense between 12 and 3 how demonic influence grows between 12 and 3. Then it starts to diminish between 3 and 6. That's why getting up at 6 o'clock is a good time to pray, because you bring prayer back the light back into control. Praying the light of God back in control, not the darkness. Go ahead.
So also, not only did I have to teach them and guide them and pray for them, but now I also had to demonstrate to them. I needed to be an example. And I probably said it 4 or 5 times at every time we had our marriage class, that example is very, very important, because they're going to follow your example before they follow what you say. So they had to see me pray. They had to see me react, or I should say respond to situations and not react.
I hit me upside the head.
Right. So and then I had to teach them balance. You know, God is in the center. He's not on the left, nor is he on the right. And, you know, on the left, we would say that would be all from Satan, you know, all the bad things, the partying, the drugs, and all that stuff. But, and you think everything on the right It's just good. You know, we go to church and we, you know, we're in the choir. And like my daughter, she was in two choirs in the college. And, you know, she was in two Bible studies. And, you know, but God had to tell me, because I was trying to figure out, how am I going to tell my daughter, you know, you need to cut down on this activity, you know, because she's not over here, but she's over here. And this is the extreme just as much as being on the wrong side. God is in the middle. So we have to learn balance, you know, and you want to reduce that time of coming out of here swinging pendulum, you know, it swings, you know. So you've got to, it's like a 5 o'clock.
Yes.
You know, you want that pendulum to just be right here in the middle. And God told me when I was walking one day years and years ago while my daughter was in college, he says, I'm in the middle. He said, I'm not, you said, he said, you know I'm not on the left. And I said, yeah, I know. He said, but I'm not on the right either. I'm not in the extreme. I'm in the middle, where there's balance. That's where you'll find me, is in the balance. So then I had, you know, ammunition to talk to my daughter while she's in college. And I said, listen, your primary goal in college is to go to school. You know, you're not up there to get into all of the good things. You're there to go to school, and plus you're under a 5-year contract. You're there to run track. I said, so you've got to stay in the middle. When you have time to go to church, you go to church. But your goal is to run track, practice, get an education. So I was able to teach her that balance, and she does very good with it even now. There's a balance where we find God. Lost my page. So in order for me to be an example, I have to have a very powerful relationship with God. I need to make sure that I'm praying and I know the word and I'm seeking God for each and every situation. I'm not about to react as you see kids and parents in the grocery stores reacting to their kids going crazy, you know. I have to learn how to respond. So I'm always seeking God's direction in each and every situation. I'm not going to react. I'm going to pray and give God's direction on how to respond to the situation. You know, that makes a big difference, you know, because I'm not only following God and the situation is being corrected very quickly, but I'm also demonstrating how you handle situations with my children. And one of the things that I, this kind of funny example that I did with my children, I would always spend, oh, maybe about 5 minutes or however long they needed with them at night right before they go to bed. And I did that all the time, about 7 days a week, unless we had my nieces and nephews over, you know, and then we kind of did it as a group. But that was my individual time that I spent with each of my children. How's things going? What's going on? You know, and in that I find out what's going on in their life, so then I can go back and pray for them. You know, so I had to have an open communication so I know what's going on in their lives every day, not once a week, but every day. And the funny thing about it is that when my son went off to college, and he would come back for the weekend. And he may go out and see his friends and whatnot, but if our bedroom door was open, he would come in our room, he would sit on the floor, you know, we may have a few words, but he would maybe be doing his sit-ups, he would do, you know, his crunches, you know, about 100 crunches, but he always had to be there in our room before he went to bed because of the habit that he was used to talking to me before he went to bed. You know, and so, and I kind of realized, I'm thinking, he's in college, you know? You know, why is he still coming and needing to have that closeness, you know, before he went to bed? Because of a habit and a pattern that I established. You know, and my daughter does it with my granddaughter, you know, and I'm sure that when my son has children that he will initiate the same thing because it was good for them. It felt good. It kept that bond together.
Can I tell the other example?
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Just talking about that bond that we were getting and dealing with our kids. This is one on my daughter. My daughter went off school and stuff. Matter of fact, I think she was about out of school, but we had a movie night. So she came over movie night and sat with us to watch a movie, and we sit there watching a movie, eating popcorn and stuff. And all of a sudden I hear my daughter holler out, "Dad, I gotta go to the bathroom." And it kind of just struck me right then. I went, "Babe, you're 26 years old. You don't have to let me know when you gotta go to the bathroom." but it just dawned on me that the closeness we have had and dealing with them, that those habits carry on. As just an example, if you just be consistent in what you do when they're young, it'll take them through their adult life.
Yes, yes. Now, one of the things that we'll probably pass out in our marriage class was to teach our kids about who we're talking about having faith in. They've got to know, you know, we say, oh, with Jesus, you know, and God and Father. Well, you know, the scripture gives us in Psalms, we've got 150 Psalms to know who God is. And so I had gone to a marriage conference and I understood, and they talked about this pattern of reading the Psalms in 30 days. And I wish I had brought it with me today, but you know, I can bring some later and pass them out. But it's a plan to read the Psalms in 30 days. You read 5 Psalms a day, and in 30 days you have read the whole 150. So now, my kids, we started that reading plan, you know, and they picked it up. It became a habit with them. And then, so that gives them an understanding of who God is. And then, we also got into Proverbs. There's 31 Proverbs. So that means you can read one a day. So now Proverbs gives you the wisdom of God. You know, so I wanted to get that into them so that when they get to know who God is, get to know the wisdom of God, so that when they go off to college, they're not going to stray. You know, because it's in them. You know, it's ingrained. So when the situations come up, what's coming out? The Word. You know, and so I had confidence in them when they went off to college that they're not going to stray, not on the right, on the left side. My daughter went on the right side, but you know, that was easy to bring her back to. But they're not dealing and not getting into all of the negative stuff on the left side. So I also taught them how to pray. And I don't know if it was good or bad, because they started using it against me. You know, so in that respect, it was bad. You know, teach the kids how to pray. You know, you want something, how to pray. You know, and then God would come in, and I'd be like, no, why? You know, and God would be like, they prayed. You got to do it. You know, I'm thinking, oh my gosh, they didn't pray again. You know, but that was a good thing, really. You know, I mean, I wish they prayed in Bug Michael, but they would always pray, and I had to be the one to do it. You know, but it's all good though. But now they can.
They did give me though.
They did.
They sent down General Motors.
Ooh, you want to talk about that?
That's not actually true. My kids, when they got in trouble, we put ourselves out here, and like I say, it can be different from you, but we're not exaggerated in our situation that the Lord has led us and put us in. My kids would get into situations and pray about it, and God would shut down drone motors so I can come home. This didn't happen not once.
Now you got to understand, this is General Motors. They don't run out of parts.
No.
What if the company corporation runs out of
parts? Run out of parts, contaminated paint, all kind of, would shut down the whole plant so I can go home and deal with them and be with them in certain situations. Not just once, not just a handful, but several times, God showed himself.
It would be kind of comical sometimes. Be like, okay, what are we prepared for now? Yeah. I mean, it'd be just as simple as my daughter wanted him to be at his track meet, and it was during the day and on a work day. And then the Lord would shut down General Motors so he can be at a track meet.
And not too long ago, we have been talking about it maybe several weeks before, you know, we reminisce and stuff, but then not too long ago with my granddaughter, my granddaughter was very upset about 3 years ago that I couldn't be home for Thanksgiving. I had to go in that night, and I wouldn't generally when I get up to be that late afternoon. And she was very adamant and serious about it. Granddaddy, I want you home for Thanksgiving. I said, but baby, I gotta go to work. And she cried a little bit and stuff, and I felt bad, so I went on to work that evening. Got to work. God, this is so good. Got to work. Before I even get in the door, people come out and say, go home. I said, go home for what? We just had a big fire. Nobody got hurt, but the fire affected the machines where they couldn't run the machines. So I was not only home for Thanksgiving, but I was home for the day after. 3 days. God marked it with 3 days. I've got 3 days off with pay. 3 days off because my granddaughter wanted me home for Thanksgiving.
Now, you know, we should always, you know, we see our kids, you know, and I'm not saying, don't get me wrong, our kids weren't perfect, you know, but I would try to catch everything with God's help to nip it in the bud. So my prayer, especially with my son, because he was a strong-willed child, still is.
There you go.
He said, there you still is. But you know, there was, so I would, you know, the Bible tells us about that we should speak those things that be as though they, when they're not, as though they are when they're not, you know? So I would speak, when I'm praying, and I would pray in my children's ears so that they can hear. Because what I pray, what I say to them about them, they're gonna rise to that occasion. Either be a negative or be positive. So I wanted mine to be positive. So one of the things that I said in the prayer that was an ongoing prayer was, Lord, give them the spirit of love, your spirit of wisdom, and your spirit of excellence. And Lord, open up their ears so that they can hear you. Not only hear you, Lord, but to follow you. And I've prayed that, especially to my son, you know, for years. And now he has the spirit of excellence all over him. He has favor that I didn't ask for, but that came with it.
Oh man, he got favor.
You know, and everything he does in excellence. And so my prayer was answered. You know, and so, I mean, if it happens to me, it can happen to everybody. You pray for your kids. You put the right thoughts and the right and who they are. We build them up so that they will be godly children. So, I have this one thing that I got an acronym on marriage. M. Make time to talk, to laugh, to be together. Make every moment count. A, ask for forgiveness and forgive freely. Affirm your spouse daily. R, rely on God and pray together out loud. This will transform your married life, reconcile often with apology and forgiveness. The second R, remind him you love him every day. Respond with respect. I, initiate in intimacy. Initiate with courage. A, argue with dignity. Always love gracefully. G, guard your words in his presence and out of his presence. Generously serve your spouse. E, exalt the best, ignore the rest, and pray that he will do the same. Endure through hardship together. That's the acronym of a marriage.
God bless. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
You just took up a little of your time to kind of give you an example about what marriage is all about and reflecting on what this day is all about. But this day should not be one day. Because of the position of the woman, because of the position of the wife, we should honor, and we used to be taught to honor. See, I'm old school. My mom, first authority in my life was my mom, and she taught me well. So when a young lady, a woman, lady, girl, anybody of female nature walks up to a door, I'm opening the door. I'm opening that door. I'm helping her with a seat. You're not just honoring them as being a woman, you're honoring them as being a possible mother, because they're the gateway into this life. Other than that, well, the 60 says, the women's lip thing, if you can do, I can do it better. Well, they had a big competition between the men. It's not a question of being lack of intellect. It's not a question of being a lack of strength. It's about your spiritual position in this world, and what God has for you to do. And we're gonna really delve into this in our next session, marriage session, on covering in that order of authority and why it exists. Because God said, in all your getting, get understanding. We run around here with knowledge, and the word says knowledge puffs up. Reason knowledge is puffing us up because we don't have understanding. God never said, all you're getting, get knowledge, did he? He emphasized getting understanding. Get that understanding. In the process of developing our marriage class, God gave me this thing. Y'all have heard me say this before. He said, my people are running around playing these roles as husband and wife and don't even understand what the play is all about.
That's right.
My people, he didn't say everybody. He said, my people are running around playing these roles as husband and wife and don't even understand what the play is all about. Well, I'm here to tell you right now, the play is all about imitating, reflecting what God is all about. What's that first definition? What is marriage? Come on, y'all wrote it down. Tell me. There you go. Male and female. You can just remember that one thing. And then they can't come on TV and tell you that Mary and Mary can get married. No, Mary and Mary can't get married. Or Sam and Sam can get married. No, Sam and Sam don't reflect the image and likeness of God. It's got to be a male and female. And when you study that out, when he created Adam, it was all in Adam. And he said it was not good for Adam to be alone. Why wasn't it good for Adam to be alone? Because Adam was created in the totality of what the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit was all about. And that's not good for him to be alone, because love, without something to express itself upon, becomes self-centered, self-in. And what happens then when you become self-centered? God himself, who is love, don't even express himself as being one. He expresses himself as being Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So it's not good for Adam to be alone, because Adam needed something to express that love on. So that's what today is all about. Motherhood. Loving. Nurturing. Expressing that love. Now I'm going to leave you with this scripture. Two of them. Exodus 20:12. And when something is very important in the Bible, God generally puts it in there twice. And the other one is Ephesians 6:2. Write it down. write it down and remind yourself of this. Because it says that we are to honor our mother and our father. And this is the commandment with what? Not just the promise, the first promise. The first promise. I don't care what all you've been through. I do care, but it's not significant in what you need to do. None of us had perfect parents. Some of us didn't even have parents at all. But if you know them, if you love God, to honor God is to honor that parent regardless. And then God's going to honor you with long life. Can I have everyone stand, please? We serve an awesome God that really loves us. He loves us so much that he sets up an order for us, order of being, that we may love him back. Because we can't love him any old way that we want to love him. That's just like saying that because he is holy, with my dirty feet, I'm going to walk in his holy room. Because I had a grandmother, if you had dirty feet, you weren't walking in on her white carpet rug. You know what I'm saying? So he set up a purpose for us to clean our feet. So we can come into him because he loves us. He wants us to come into him. But he loved us so much that he looked to his side and saw his son and said, "Son, I can't go down there myself because of my holiness. Because I am heaven. I am love. But son, can you make that sacrifice for me and go down there and tell my people how much I love them?"
Yes, Lord.
And his son looked up to him and said, "Father, I love them too. I'm going to take off all that you have given me, Dad. I'm going to take off knowing everything. I'm going to take off long life. I'm going to take off your holiness. I'm going to take off all that we are about. And I'm going to go down there. And I'm going to take on all their sins. I'm going to take on everything that they did that came against you, Father God." So when you have to shove out your wrath, when you have to make judgment on them, don't judge them. Judge me. I'll take it. I'm paying that price.
Yes.
Yes, his name was Jesus. The Son of the Most High God. Came down here, paid that price, sacrificed himself that we may be saved. He became poor that we may be rich. All we have to do is accept and believe in our heart that he did what he did for us. And in doing so, it will put us back in right standing with the Father, that we can now, with clean shoes, walk into his holiness boldly and say, "Daddy." We no longer call him God. We call him Father God. He's no longer so far away that we can't touch him. But through Jesus, he now lives in our heart.
Yes.
Unlike David, we don't have to look to the hills from where our help comes from. All you got to do is look inwardly. Look inwardly. Name was Jesus, Yeshua. So I want to know if there's anyone out there who give you the opportunity to come and know this Son of God.
Yeshua. To ask him into your heart that you, it doesn't necessarily mean that all your troubles are going to pass away, but it does mean that he will give you the strength to walk through the shadows.
Yes,
yes. Not only just walk through the shadows, but with a joy and a gladness as you're going through, knowing that he is and he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Knowing that when you come out on the other side, all things work together for the good of those. Do you hear me, church? All, he didn't say something. All things. But you got to know him. You got to have that relationship. If there's anyone in here that desires that relationship, let me see by just quickly raising your hand. Oh, just take care of those that did by all day. I don't have any hands at this moment. So if you can just bow your heads. You are mighty God. We just thank you, Lord. We come to you right now, Father God, with an attitude of thanksgiving, a humbleness, a brokenness, knowing that you God and God all by yourself. But we like to, Father God, I like to represent those, and those who want to stand with me, just say in, under your breath or in your mind, just say, amen. I like to come to represent those who didn't understand what your marriage is all about. So we repent, Father God, because I was there too. I didn't know when Denise and I first got married. I didn't know. I thought I was supposed to come in and just take over the situation, be the man and just run it. You know what I'm saying, God? But I didn't know that there was a love and that you had to strengthen me to be able to walk like Christ, because in Christ we are able to walk in and out of his life, and his love does not cease to exist, because he'll love us regardless. He promised never to leave us or forsake us. And I must have that same love, that same attitude, that same being with my wife, that I promise you, God, never to leave her or forsake her. So I repent for those times. I repent for those. I come representing those who might have been hung up in that state of mind, Father God. Belittling and denigrating our mothers, your gateway into this world. But I also like to, Father God, in the name of Jesus, touch each and every woman out here with the possibility of being a mom, and those that are mom, touch them and anoint them with the strength to hear your voice and to be and do everything that you will have them to do, because sometimes there's an absentee father in this home. So strengthen them, Father God. Give them that knowledge to touch their children, because out of their children, out of that relationship will come great kids. Godly kids, Father God. And I just thank you right now for Northside Christian Center as we grow and develop in the Word. I thank you for our pastor that you have given that heart to teach us that Word. I thank you for his wife on this Mother's Day that has stood by his side. I've been around a lot of pastors, and I know it's very hard for a pastor's wife, because we have to take on, pastors' wives have to take on some things that when the ministry pulls them away, that goes beyond. They have to accept and just kind of bite their tongue over things because people around them don't act the way they're supposed to be acting. So I just touch Mrs. Hill right now and ask you to remove any hurt and pain she might have encountered during these last 41 years as being a pastor's wife on this Mother's Day. And anoint her for another 41 years, Father God. That she may be an example to those who are now coming up.
Yes.
And Father God, touch the family that sacrificed the time that the pastor had to sacrifice in doing things that are necessary in the ministry. Because today is all about motherhood. Today is all about motherhood. And whether our mothers are here with us now or there with you, Father God, we just thank you for them because they were the gateway that we were able to come into this world. And in all that we do, Father God, all that we do, we will give you the praise. We will give you the glory, and we give you the honor. But not in disrespect for you, but because of you, Father God, I just want to give a shout out to motherhood. Hallelujah. Thank you for motherhood. Glory to God. Thank you. Thank you. Oh, thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Lord. And Father God, it will be very, very, very negligent of me, Father God, if I don't take this opportunity to give you, to ask you, thanks for my wife. Oh, Lord Jesus. You know what she's been through to deal with me. You know what she had to do to forgive me. As I grow in you, Father God. So I thank you on this day of motherhood for my wife. But I want to thank you and who she is as Denise Donaldson. And bless her, Lord. Anoint her that she may continue in this ministry and help educate, touch other women. Keep her strong in supporting me as being my helpmate. And most of all, keep that spirit of forgiveness because I make a lot of mistakes, Lord, as you know. So thank you, Lord, for Denise. Thank you for all women. Thank you for all mothers on this Mother's Day. And we give you all the praise and glory. And everybody in agreement with this prayer say amen.
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 I don't want to hold you up much longer because I know some of us want to go out here and show our personal expectation or our personal party with our mothers and those that we love ones. So I'm in all due diligence. Did you have anything you want to say? Anything else? God bless you all. Make sure you come to our marriage class because we just give you a little touch of it. I didn't want to excite you in the touch that we'll get you, but I wanted to excite you into coming in, not to build you up with a mighty shout, but come in and sit down and be humbled and understand that we have been deceived in this world as to what marriage is all about, and we need to go back to the roots. We need to rebuild the foundation so we can start producing on the massive level godly kids. Here's your pastor, my spiritual father, and mother. Pastor Hill.
All right.
Praise God. warm your hearts. Warm your hearts with all of us can relate in some respect on this Mother's Day from the words that we receive. I just praise the Lord for those timely teachings and exhortations in the area of motherhood, in the area of the family and marriage. We're just so grateful for their presentation. So I just want Sister Hill to come and have remarks and go from there. I'm so happy for my better half. She said, yeah, that's right.
Amen, amen, amen. Didn't we enjoy the Donaldsons?
Amen.
It's truly a blessing. Amen. See, if you didn't come to the marriage class, see what you missed? Every Saturday evening for 6 weeks. Amen. It was rich. But for all the mothers, the children, I just want you to make sure you do something special for your mother today. Something special. Don't forget your mother. Because I'm going to tell you like that song Shirley Caesar sings, for 9 months, we carried you with no charge. 9 months, no charge. Amen. 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 Can I get amen on that?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. I'm not going to go any further because that'll preach right there. All right.
All those months after the 9 months.
Yes. Can you hear me on this?
Yeah. Right. All the months after then. And how many of you know that when they were small, you can just come and pastor pray. Who did they call? Mom, you know, I heard, you know, I have a call. Mom, this is her. This is her. And did they ever call Dad? Most of the time it was Mom. You all come. This is Mother's Day. Fathers, you'll have your new brother Sammy. We're so glad to see it. Hey, y'all move. Come on. We're so glad because we're going to get out of here this morning. It's not going to be the afternoon. We're so glad to see Sister Deborah Williams here today, my sister, our sister. Amen. And we continue to uphold her in prayer. And I know that those of us that have lost loved ones, we rally behind when it's doing the services, and after everything is over, we tend to kind of, well, and go on. But that's the time that you really need somebody. So we don't want to forget Sister Deborah. Amen. Amen. All right. God bless you, Pastor.
And we just want to say we really appreciate the courage and the faith and the tenacity how Sister Deborah has held up. I know she shed many tears, but she's a strong lady of the Lord. We just thank God for how God has sustained her and how those roots are deep and how God has prepared us. It's like a stem. The powerful stem is in its ability to stick to the end of the journey. Amen. So we just thank God for her strength and the love of God that Holy Spirit has shed in her heart. I just want to make one mention. Brother Sammy had told me about a friend whose mother was on the verge of death about two or three weeks ago. And he wanted me to pray or to connect with her, but before I could connect, his best friend's mother had passed. And brother, after she had passed, I suggested that I still would make contact with his best friend. And we, Bella Semi, arranged that. And this past week, we were able to minister to his best friend. Over, what, 15 years or 20 years? 15? Long time. And almost 30. That best spirit is here today. Brother Kelvin. Would you stand, Brother Kelvin? Not only was we met him, but we ministered to him, and he gave us life to the Lord. He was so elated to know that when Jesus comes, he and his mother are going to be reunited. And he left with peace and joy and victory in his heart. Great young man, very ambitious, very powerful and dynamic young man. And Brother Sammy's life helped to draw him to Jesus. And we're just so thankful for that. Amen. And he's here today. He promised me. And he's going to reunite. He's going to unite with our ministry here. And we just thank God for him. Brother Sammy Minister. God bless you. This is all. Okay, everybody, stand as we pray, both blessed and dismissed. Father, we thank you for your grace. Your grace is sufficient. And you are able to cause all grace to abound toward us so we will have sufficiency in everything. We thank you for this day. We thank you for the words that we have received and how you have warmed our hearts and filled us, God, with knowledge and revelation of your will. We pray as we leave this place, and we leave knowing that you begun the good work within us, and you who have begun the good work, you shall continue to perform it. Our eyes upon you, and we give you praise and glory. Now lead and direct us and bring us back at the appointed time. We thank you for every giver, and we thank you, God, for the blessings that you make it rich and added no sorrow to those that give in faith. Father, we thank you and we give you praise in Jesus' name. Everybody said together, amen. God bless. Be dismissed. Yes.
Don't forget, mothers, to stop by the table where Kimberly is and get your fan and your flowers. Mothers, surrogate mothers, women. Okay.